Itself.
I'll first introduce you. We are live.
Okay. Thank you.
A very good morning to everyone, and thank you for joining in. On behalf of Nehru Planetarium, Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, myself, Prerna Chandra, welcome you all for being part of this Space Week celebration starting from today, that is 4th October. The entire week is filled with exciting learning webinars for all the space enthusiasts. If we talk about today's special date, it is also have some connection related to our topic of the discussion. We all remember that Sputnik 1 was the first artificial Earth satellite launched into an elliptical low Earth orbit by the USSR on 4th October 1957 as a part of Soviet. Our today's discussion will also discuss detail on the space exploration program and use of astronomy and space technology to explore the outer space. To talk more on the detail of the subject, we have with us Mr. Srishel Roth. Mr. Roth is a space engineer who is currently pursuing his PhD in space satellite geodesy from GFZ German Research Center in Germany. He earned his master's degree in space engineering from University Berlin, Germany. He is also a co-founder of Brahman, the astronomy club of Pandit Deen Dayal Energy University, PDEU, Gandhinagar, Gujarat. Planetarium, welcome you, sir, for joining for today's discussion. All budding minds are interested to know more detail about the space exploration.
Thank you, Prerna ma'am, for the kind introduction. And let us begin with the presentation. I'll share my screen. I hope my screen, my presentation is visible.
Yes, it's visible, and there is a small taskbar coming on your screen. I request you to kindly just, you can cross it also.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Okay. Good morning to you all. I am Srishel Raut, and today I will be speaking about space exploration, the past, the present, and the future. So, let us begin. Before starting the presentation, we should always start with a good saying. So I quote the famous astronomer Carl Sagan, "Across the sea of space, the stars are the other suns," unquote. Space exploration. What is space exploration? Space exploration is basically the use of astronomy and space technology to outer space. One may ask, what is outer space? Outer space is a space which is an area which starts around 100 kilometers above Earth's surface. So I think you can tell me which satellite is this. This is a famous Hubble telescope, which gave us tremendous amounts of wonderful images and has contributed greatly to the science. So the space exploration can be basically carried out in two ways. The one is the astronomers with the help of the instruments such as optical telescopes, radio telescopes, etc. And this has been done since centuries. The more recent one is the physical kind of exploration. There are two ways to do that. One is the by sending unmanned rovers and by sending humans into the space. And it all started with the space race. I think everybody knows about the space race. It was during the Cold War between US and the Soviet Union, which is now known as Russia. To give you an analogy, the Cold War is similar, something like which is going on between USA and China. So, to mark the 64th anniversary, so I will begin with the first satellite launched into the space, which was the Sputnik, which also marked the arena of the Cold War. It was launched on October 4th, 1957. It was launched using a Soviet R-7 intercontinental ballistic missile launched. And the Sputnik, the name is called as Traveler in the language Russian. And it was the world's first artificial satellite and the first man-made object to be placed into the Earth's orbit. And the Sputnik satellite was able to send out beeps from a radio transmitter. So after reaching the space, the Sputnik orbited the Earth once every 96 minutes. The radio beeps could be detected on the ground as the satellite passed overhead. So the people around the world really knew that it was in the orbit. For this, I would suggest you to watch a movie called October Sky, I think. It also starts with the Sputnik. So till now, the Soviets were beating the USA. They sent out a second satellite, which was called the Sputnik 2. On November 3rd, 1957. And the amazing part of this satellite was the satellite carried a living creature. It was a female dog called Laika. So USA finally attempts to enter the space race. So the United States made two failed attempts to launch a satellite into the space before succeeding with a rocket that carried a satellite called Explorer on January 31st, 1958. So the next, after you send the man-made objects into the space, the obvious next thing is to send humans into the orbit. And that too, the Russians were beating the USA in this regard. The first human in the space was the Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin, who made one orbit around the Earth on April 12th, 1961, which the flight lasted for around 108 minutes. A few weeks later, NASA launched its own astronaut, Alan Shepard, into the space. It was not an orbital flight, but it was a suborbital trajectory. It's basically, you just go up, you touch the space, and you come back. And recently, it was done by Jeff Bezos. I think you have heard about it. And the flight lasted just over 15 minutes. So I will be talking about these three astronauts in the next slide. And also, I would like you to note that as cosmonaut and astronaut are basically the same thing. The Americans call it astronaut, the Russians call it cosmonaut. So they are not two different things. They are the same one. A man on the moon, which was a giant leap for the mankind. In 1969, Apollo 11, the United States, the first astronauts to the moon, Neil Armstrong, along with Buzz Aldrin, became the first humans to set foot on its surface. Yeah, but let's not forget Michael Collins. He was also piloting the Apollo 11 mission. So finally, the Americans beat the Soviet in this regard. And I would like to quote Neil Armstrong, one small step for the man, one giant leap for the mankind. So now you have done all these things. So the next thing would be to build a home in the space. So obviously they made space stations, which was considered as the next phase of the space exploration. The first space station in the Earth's orbit was the Soviet Salyut Station 1, which was launched in 1971. Just to keep the score, the Russians were again beating the US in this regard. This was followed by the NASA Skylab space station. It was the first orbital lab in which the astronauts and the scientists, they studied the Earth and the effects of the space flight on a human body. During the 1970s, the NASA also carried out Project Viking, in which the two probes landed on Mars. They took numerous photographs, examined the chemistry of the Martian surface environment, and tested the Martian dirt, it's also called a regolith, for the presence of the microorganisms. So you might be wondering, why do we invest so much of money in space exploration just so as to satisfy the ego of the two big superpowers? I would say it's not. Space exploration has gave us a lot of things. So the thing which we use most commonly these days are the phone cameras. I don't think you can imagine your life without this. So the invention of the CMOS image sensors, which was used in the products such as mobile phones and GoPro, traces back to NASA JPL scientists who wanted to make small miniaturized cameras for interplanetary missions. You may ask why they wanted to make the camera small, to save some weight without compromising on the quality of the camera. Today's 1/3 of the camera contain this technology and others evolved from it. Without these, we wouldn't have cameras on our mobile phones. And this technology made everyone in our family a photographer. I think we should thank the space exploration for this. The next is the wireless headset. Doesn't the wireless headset look cool on Neil Armstrong? Imagine if we had to wear a wired earphone just like I'm wearing now, and he had to untangle the wires all the time in zero gravity. So in 1960s, the wireless communication headsets were initially developed for the astronauts during the Apollo program, and they were instrumental for carrying Neil Armstrong's famous words from the moon, the one which I had repeated before. Without this, we would be listening to the videos or lectures without a speaker or a wired medium. So thanks to this technology, we no longer need to untangle the cables to our earphones. Memory phone cushion. Most of you must be traveling in railways, in airplanes, and probably you may have a travel cushion or a sleep cushion which you can sleep on. This contains the same technology as the memory foam. Memory foam was originally invented as a pad for astronaut seats that would mold their bodies during the high forces of takeoff and landing, and they would return to their original state afterwards. The most important thing, laptop and mouse. The first portable computer, the Grid Compass, it was used on multiple shuttle missions in 1980s. And while searching for a way to increase the interaction with the onboard computers and allow users to perform tasks and manipulate data, the NASA and the Stanford researchers developed the first mouse. This technology enabled me to convey my message to you. And there are plenty of other applications and the things which it gave us. I would like to name some few. Scratch resistant lenses, the LED lights which we use in our homes. You like to run, they got the athletic shoes. Water and air purification. I think most of you guys drink purified water at your home. The ear thermometer. I think it was the important thing which was required during the corona pandemic to check the temperatures when you go to the malls. Freeze-dried food, artificial limbs, cloud computing, MRI and CAT scans, radar, and many more. Challenges to the space exploration. It all might seem very good, very fascinating, but it's not an easy cake. So let us discuss some challenges during a space exploration. The major thing which is a matter of concern is the radiation. an astronaut in space could receive a radiation doses up to 700 times, which is higher than what we receive on a planet. This is the same thing, the sun shining radiation on our planet Earth. The space radiation is made up of three different kinds of radiation. The particles which are trapped in the Earth's magnetic field, the solar flares, the galactic cosmic rays, which are from the outside from our solar system. The origin is extragalactic. How do we understand radiation? So basically, radiation is basically an energy wearing Harry Potter's cloak of invisibility that travels through the space at the speed of light. You cannot see it, you only know it when you get ill. I mean, it's also just like chocolates, but the unwanted one. In smaller quantities, smaller amounts is relatively harmless, but too much can eat up all your teeth. So what do I mean by smaller amounts? Whenever you get your hand fractured, you go to a doctor and he takes up a X-ray machine. So in small amounts, it's fine, but not much, not more than that. The cause for the concern. Cosmic radiation could increase cancer risk during long duration mission. Say that we send somebody to Mars. So that puts our astronauts on a greater risk with the exposure with the cosmic radiation. Furthermore, a higher percentage of early onset cataracts have been reported in astronauts. A recent data from ExoMars Trace Gas Orbiter showed that on a 6-month journey to the red planet, aka Mars, an astronaut could be exposed to at least 60% of the total radiation dose limit recommended for their entire career, which is for sure a very huge drawback to our Mars mission. I think Elon Musk would be sad to hear this. NASA's Kelly Twin experiment. The telomeres, which are the biomarkers of aging at the end of the chromosomes and are important for cellular genomic stability, in Scott's white blood cells were unexpectedly longer in the space than shorter after his return to Earth. In contrast, his brother's telomeres remained stable throughout the entire period. The second key finding in that Scott's immune system responded appropriately in space. Over the course of investigation, a mind-boggling of 16 billion kilometers of DNA were involved. That's approximately how far Voyager 1 is currently now. To give a perspective, 16 billion kilometers is enough to circle Earth's equator 25,000 times. Isolation and confinement. I think most of us have experienced this isolation phenomena during the corona pandemic. The social isolation takes a toll on our health. No wonder, humans are social animals. Sometimes social isolation is necessary due to emergencies like global pandemic, as this was the case with the coronavirus that caused the COVID-19 disease. The astronauts also experienced social isolation living on the International Space Station, so you can imagine how much isolation and confinement they might face during the missions to Mars and beyond. They basically get Earth sick. It's like a next version of getting homesick. How they cope up with such a social isolation? The one way astronauts endure isolation in space is knowing that their work has a social impact. Also, openness, regular communication with family helps them a lot. To stay psychologically, emotionally, and physiologically fit in such isolation, the astronauts exercise, they eat healthy, follow a sleep cycle, they have a work schedule, and they make time for leisure activities. The astronaut writes in their journals to express their feelings. It helps ease crews psychologically to reframe a situation to turn negative thought into positive. Whether you are keeping a journal or writing as a meditation, it is the same thing. What's important is you're having a relationship with your mind. It's a quote by Natalie Goldberg. These are the suggestions not only for the astronauts, but for also the budding astronauts out there. Distance from the Earth. Yeah, it would be appropriate to say the devil is in the distance. Space is always unpredictable. You don't know what's going to happen. All our calculations, even all our data, all our simulations, they are not sufficient for such hazardous trip. This impacts the planning of the logistics. Yeah, emergency meeting. Hence, any onboard emergency can only be tackled by the available clue and the logistics. I mean, if there's an emergency in the International Space Station, we currently do not have a hospital, like a running ambulance, which can be launched, can be reached there in time, and they can solve the problem. They have to do it themselves. Once you burn the engines for the Mars, there's no turning back and no resupply, whatever the emergency might be. Lack of gravity. I know you guys don't like Newton and his gravity, but here the gravity plays a vital role. And how do we define gravity? I mean, it's a force which only acts when you look down, like in the Tom and Jerry show. Just kidding. Other than helping the movement from one place to another, how blood pumps, a sense of balance, the bone growth are all due to gravity. We take this for granted, but trust me, if there's no gravity, your body cannot handle it. So obviously, if the body is adapted to this Earth's gravity, so there are going to be effects of the weightlessness. So this is how the body adapts with the zero gravity conditions and how it normalizes after you return back from the space. Weightlessness alleviates your mechanical strain on our body and heart. This may cause temporary visual impairment due to increased blood flow to your head. It makes the bones weak and they increase the risk of fracture. So what do? They exercise to maintain the blood and the bone mass and muscle growth. The fifth point is the hostile environment out there. The spacecraft is just not a machine. It's also home to the crew. Everything needs to be monitored, from air quality to every possible bacterial, microbial inhabitants. We need to know who else are living else over there other than human beings. They extensively recycle resources that we take for granted. Oxygen, water, carbon dioxide, even our waste, everything is recycled. The slightest change of the atmosphere can be very catastrophic for the crew. I think you have seen the movie Interstellar and the Martian. Slight change in the air pressure can blow up the station or your lab. Any guesses what this could be? So it is called the pale blue dot. This is the first ever portrait of our solar system, which was taken by Voyager 1 from a distance of more than 6.5 billion kilometers from Earth. And please don't mind the blurred photo. I mean, it was from February 14, 1990. We didn't have iPhones at that time. Voyager 1 was launched on September 5th, 1977 to observe the outer solar system and the interstellar space. It studied the Jupiter and its moon, and it officially entered the interstellar space on August 2012, almost 35 years after its voyage began. This was the photo taken by the Voyager 1. On board was a special golden record, which contained the voices and the music from Earth. It marked the humanity's culture, history, and science on its grand journey out in the cosmos. this is the a picture of the golden record. Rovers, which can also be dubbed as the tools of exploration. It is a planetary surface exploration device designed to move across solid planetary surfaces, as shown in the picture. And the recent rover was the Curiosity rover by NASA. So basically, they have several advantages over the landers and the orbiters, as they can conduct physical experimentation. They can examine more and more land, and the advantage is they are solar powered, so they can continue the research. They can collect the sample, they can analyze it, and we can exactly know what's in the soil of, for example, let's say Mars. Rovers can reach to the harshest places where we cannot send manned missions. And the highlight probably for this year, the James Webb Telescope. This telescope is meant to it's a successor of the Hubble telescope, and it contains multiple mirrors. The James Webb Telescope is the next great space science observatory following Hubble. It will serve as the humanity's eye to view the distant cosmos. Due to its massive size, it will barely fit into a normal rocket. For this, it had to be designed in space like origami, just like you fold, like you make a boat, something like that. They are going to fold it from here, from Earth. It is going to be launched, and the magnificent telescope will open its mirror like a flower, like a blossoming flower. It is hoped to be launched this year on December 18th. Now let's move on to our own ISRO's exploration programs. So let's begin with Aditya L1 reaching the sun. Aditya L1 is expected to study the solar corona. Corona is a part when there is a total solar eclipse. The thing which you can see is visible, it's the solar corona, which is also why we should not look at directly at the solar during a solar total eclipse. It is also the outermost part of the sun's atmosphere. The next one is the moon mission. It's a collab with Japan. Scientific experiments. Moving on, the next one is the Gaganyaan, the most awaited, the first manned mission of ISRO. The three Indian astronauts are expected to fly in the space in the country's first human spaceflight mission in 2023 by carrying them to the low Earth orbit and safely bringing them back. One may ask, what is low Earth orbit? I mean, these are the orbits which are around 400 to 1000 kilometers above Earth's surface. Mangalyaan 2. I think we can expect another movie from Akshay Kumar after this satellite is launched. So the success of Mangalyaan has prompted the space agency to send a double second probe by 2024, which will conduct extensive and more deeper studies of Earth's closest neighbor. And it might help us to understand the evolution of the red planet much better. The next one is the mission Shukrayaan 1, planned to be launched in 2024. Shukratara means Venus. I think you can see it is visible as the evening star these days. And the ISRO plans to launch a mission over there. The space agency will fly a spacecraft around 400 kilometers over Venus to conduct research and understand its formation, its wind, its interaction with the solar wind. AstroSat, the origin of the universe. It's the India's second observatory planned in space. It will be a multi-wavelength space telescope, which is aimed at looking at the origin of the universe and discover new planets. India also plans to send a space station, just like the International Space Station. The plan is by 2025, and the International Space Station is planned to be decommissioned around 2028, which is a good thing. So the Indian Space Station can take over the ISS. And there are some major reforms in the Indian space sector in order to enhance the diffusion of the space technology and boost the space economy within the country. The Department of Space desires to encourage the participation of private companies in space activities. Earlier, it was quite difficult to set up a private, but now you can have your own space startup. Maybe you could be the next Elon Musk. So this is the basic timeline of the ISRO's mission. Some of them, the green ones, they were the launched. They are already launched. The yellow one represents the planned future missions. So please, you can understand the chronology from this. So this World Space Week, the theme of the World Space Week is women in space. So we decided to have a slide for this, exactly the same thing. So we would like to dedicate to Sunita Williams. She holds the record of the longest space flight by a woman. She's also an Indian origin, by the way. In all, she has been on 7 spacewalks in August 2007. She also became the first person to run a marathon in space. Kalpana Chawla, the first woman of Indian origin to fly into the space. I used to idolize her when I wanted to become an astronaut. So yeah, she flew the first. She flew on the Space Shuttle Columbia in 1997 as a mission specialist and primary robotic arm operator. Unfortunately, she died during her second mission due to landing failure. Mangalyaan was India's maiden mission to Mars, launched on 5th of November 2013 by ISRO. The mission had a team of about 500 people working it to make a success, but a major driving force behind the mission were the women. This is the famous photograph during the success of Mangalyaan. Ritu Karidal, she is known as the Rocket Woman of India. She was a deputy operations director to the India's Mars orbital mission Mangalyaan. So thank you. So what future holds for the space exploration? Maybe we can have more women in space to have more representation. Till 2020, only 10% of astronauts who have been to the space were women. Mass colonization, maybe. I mean, that's Elon Musk's dream, and but let's see how far we can get. It would be really, really an exciting thing to have a colony on Mars as well. The urgency to establish humanity as a multi-planet species has been revalidated by emergence of a worldwide pandemic. Discovering an extraterrestrial life. That would be really cool if we could find some extraterrestrial life. We are surely not alone in this galaxy. They might know the answer to our question of origin of life. So let's hope that the extraterrestrial life finds us. So we would recommend some books for you to read. My personal favorite would be Cosmos, which is written by Carl Sagan. There are some of the Indian textbooks which were written, I think, a millennia ago. Surya Siddhanta by Varaha Hira. Aryabhattam by Aryabhatta, the famous Indian mathematician. The more you will read, the more things you will learn. And the more you will learn, the more places you will go. So I will like to end the talk with the famous dialogue given by John F. Kennedy, who was the US president, who gave this talk when they landed the first moon on first man on the moon. So I would like to quote him: "We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard." I like this line. So thank you for your attention. Please let me know if you have any questions. And you can also follow us on the social media. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Roth, for sharing such a wonderful presentation on the present, past, and the future of space exploration program. And also the presentation gave us insight about why these programs are so much important for the common people. Generally, we think that the nation is spending so much money on this program, but it is really important for the common man as well. And very rightly you said that more you read, more you understand, that what we were discussing earlier during the before the presentation actually, because we are dealing with the young minds, and students have this notion that without reading you can understand many things, because books are the really good source and very credible source to get the authentic information and detailed theoretical knowledge about the cosmos. So thank you for sharing that, and thank you for putting that point to the young minds.
And thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Yes, thank you. We'll open the session. We'll take some questions or doubt if anybody have. You can write in the chat box, and then I'll highlight those questions and your doubts so that our expert can answer those. Anyone would like to ask anything?
Is my video visible?
For now, your screen got little freezed.
Okay. Then I'll join again.
Yeah.
Sorry. I'm back again.
Yeah. One question we got from Innovative Creative, that will the Chandrayaan will be going again in 2022? So any update related to the Chandrayaan mission?
I'm not aware as of now. Most of the space missions, they got delayed because of the corona pandemic.
I think, but this year, most probably in 2022, it is to be expected, as if now, whatever little information we got from the ISRO's portal, that most probably in 2022, the Chandrayaan will launch again.
Yeah, it is expected, but...
It's expected, but nothing is yet finalized.
Because the space missions, the expectations, I mean, they get delayed by a decade or so. So...
And somebody same with the same question, when Chandrayaan 2 will happen, is the same answer to all those who are interested in Chandrayaan. So most probably keep yourself updated with the ISRO website. Soon they will announce the date, we'll come to know. The orbiter has done its work really very greatly, and we got really good information. So most probably in 2022 or maybe in 23, when the date is decided by the ISRO, will be witnessing the Chandrayaan mission.
Okay.
A student, I request kindly put relevant question in the chat box, because then it becomes really difficult for us to check. Has any satellite reached another galaxy?
I think I mentioned about the Voyager 1. It is currently 6.5 billion kilometers away from Earth as of now. And it is expected in near future, if the Voyager 1 still survives, it can probably reach another galaxy.
To what extent is space debris harmful for upcoming space mission, or in general, maybe? I think he's interested.
So space debris is a general concern for all the space agencies across the world. And most of the space debris is situated in the low Earth orbit, which is 400 to 1000 kilometers above Earth. And most of the missions are in those in that range. So there are many companies which are working on tracking the space debris, and they are trying to keep a tab on it. So the newer missions which are being launched, they are launched accordingly so that it does not come in the pathway of such debris. And and the future missions, the satellites have already been made such that they will deorbit and safely fall into the Earth atmosphere after their planned mission. So a lot of effort is going on to not to create more debris in the future.
Will India send a space exploration mission to the outer planet like Jupiter and Saturn?
I think it's not planned as of now, but we do have planned missions to Shukrayan. So we might expect after they send the missions to Shukrayan and Aditya, we might have a satellite which is called Guruyan or Shaniyan in probably in near future.
So these are... definitely, we cannot comment on this, obviously, because the planned mission, the relative success rate which we get from the planned mission called Shukrayaan or the human which we are sending to the space will give us no Gaganyaan, will give us new direction to work on these areas, definitely.
And also the thing is, to send missions to Jupiter and Saturn, we require a lot of money. So. So it will in your future.
I think someone is interested to know the first astronaut. I don't think there's any name is yet finalized, or the ISRO has announced that who will be going. From India, I think. I think
the first astronaut was from India was Rakesh Sharma, ISRO did not launch him. It was the Soviet program.
I think Neha is interested. If I am right, she wants to know from India is not like which we are planned our human mission now. So space. I think she is interested to know the name is not yet finalized yet.
The names are finalized, but they are not being
disclosed.
They are not disclosed due to privacy issues, security.
Yes. Please tell something more about James Webb Telescope.
I can go on and on about the James Webb Telescope. This is basically the successor of Hubble telescope, and it is planned to be launched this year, and I think it's 10 times bigger than the Hubble telescopes, which will enable the diameter is around 7 meters, and this will enable us to capture what Hubble telescope could not capture till now. And this will also, we will also study the universe in infrared region, which is the different wavelength. One is the visible and one is the infrared. And the good part of the telescope is it has in multiple individual mirrors which can be controlled independently to get the best result.
Hope you got the clarification related to the telescope question. Hansel Shah, what are the odds of coming across extraterrestrial life?
I think there is a number given by some scientist. I don't remember the number, maybe you can Google it, but the chances are quite bleak. And obviously there are many conspiracy theories which we should not believe regarding these.
And some one is also interested how many galaxies are there in the universe.
We don't know the exact absolute number of the galaxies in the universe, but we can tell how many galaxies we have observed. So it is expected there might be a couple of trillion or 3 trillion galaxies in the universe.
And very repeatedly we're getting the question about the Kalpana Chawla, because Neil Armstrong is the first astronaut to go to the moon or the Kalpana Chawla. I think students have this question again and again. They're posting related to the Kalpana Chawla.
Okay, so Neil Armstrong was the first astronaut to land on the, to step foot on the moon. And Kalpana Chawla was one of the astronauts who was stationed at the International Space Station, and she went to the ISS a couple of times. So International Space Station is a man-made, a human-made lab which is orbiting the Earth. I hope that yeah.
How many moons are there in our ecosystem total?
So it depends on what you define as ecosystem.
Exactly.
Do you say Earth or do you say solar system?
Rakhi Chawla, can you please put your question again, because I think very fast the questions are coming in the chat box. Probably your question goes up. What is the effect of radiation? As you said, astronaut receives 700 times that our planet.
So just to give you an idea, I don't know if you have seen the web series called Chernobyl, which talks about the Chernobyl power plant explosion. So the radiation, basically, when you receive excess doses of radiation, basically your DNA gets altered. That's why staying long in the sunlight, which contains the UVA radiation, can cause skin cancer, because this radiation causes changes in your DNA. And if you face if you get a dose of a lot of radiation, you might die within a couple of days, because it alters everything which is inside your body.
I think this is related to you as a professional. What is the difference between space engineering and aerospace engineering?
Okay, so in space engineering, we focus more on the launching of the satellites and anything which is above 100 kilometers from the Earth's surface. And aerospace engineering is more of a general discipline, which also incorporates the aeroplanes, some of the aspects of the space engineering as well. So I would say space engineering is a more narrow field, which only specifically focuses on space exploration.
How does astronaut overcome cosmic radiation?
Yeah, that's a good question. It is nearly impossible to cut down all the radiation which we receive, which the astronauts receive. But the space station, they are fitted with hardened material, radiation hardened material, which prevents some of the radiation from entering the space station. And whenever they do a spacewalk, I hope you know that they wear a space suit, and this space suit also protects them from partially from the radiation.
Students are interested to know the name of the Kalpana Chawla rocket, if you can.
I think it was the one which she died, or
because she has traveled quite several times to the space station. I think they are interested to know which got crashed.
Okay. I think it was the Columbia mission. Columbia mission, I think. The space shuttle Columbia mission, yeah. Yeah, Columbia mission.
Which is the smallest moon in the universe? So,
I don't know the name of the moon, but I think it's one of the moon of Jupiter, which is very small and is also considered as an asteroid, which got trapped into the Jupiter's gravity. But I can tell you the biggest moon, which is Ganymede, which is a moon of Jupiter.
Jupiter. Has anyone landed on a planet beside Moon and Mars?
What do you mean, anyone apart from, I mean, from
apart
Indian?
From India, I think.
Yeah, I mean, there are a lot of space agencies which are quite ahead of us. I think the US Space Agency, NASA, and the I think the Chinese have also sent their mission.
And if you want to see the entire chronology, please come to the planetarium. We have the entire graph of the entire missions. Whosoever country has landed over the Mars. Why Pluto is not a planet? Because
the astronomical International Astronomical Union, they changed the definition of what they define as a planet. So unfortunately, Pluto went out.
Because if they have to consider Pluto as a planet, then there are many other similar looking planet with the same mass, gravity, weight, and everything. So they have to give, beside Pluto, they have to also include them. So according to their recent definition, they didn't consider Pluto as a planet.
Yes.
So we'll take last question with this. Sir, can we build an artificial atmosphere on Mars?
So at Mars, in general, has an atmosphere. It's a thin atmosphere. So because the mass is quite small, it has less gravity. So it cannot hold on to, it cannot have a thick atmosphere, but it indeed has a thin atmosphere. There are probably plans in the future to transform the planet. There is also one possibility where they can transform the composition of the atmosphere. I mean, we can have more oxygen, but it's a very challenging task, and in my opinion, it might be a quite impossible one.
So I think people asking again and again the same question about the Pluto. So I'll really request you to kindly read about the recent definition, which, because according to them, the definition they have given, which define the planet as totality. So Pluto didn't consider in, Pluto doesn't fall in that category, because Pluto ke jaise bahut se aise aur planet hai jo same weight or same specification rakhte hain. So agar Pluto ko hame planet bolna padega, to hame unko bhi planet bolna padega. Because of this thing happening, so they didn't include the Pluto in the solar system, because there are many other similar looking planets. So this is the only reason why that Pluto is not more in the solar system. And hope you got the clarification.
And I would also like to add a point for the Pluto. As we know, Pluto has a moon which is called Charon or Charon. I don't know how it is pronounced. So it is the Charon and the Pluto. Charon does not revolve around Pluto, but it is said that it is the revolve around each other. So that basically is not a definition of a planet, something like that. But I think you should read more on this.
Yes. So with this, I think we'll wrap today's session, and also would like to give you the reminder that on 6th, we have one more webinar lined up at 3 p.m. So we request you to kindly tune in to the Planetarium YouTube handle. It is about the enigmatic universe. So in that, we'll be covering all the exciting, unknown and hidden facts about the wonderful universe. I think these questions which you have in your mind, you can ask there related to the expert, because this will give you more clarification there. So with this, thank you for joining in. Thank you, Mr. Roy, for coming and sharing the presentation with Young Mind. Thank you, dear participants, for coming and sharing your precious time with us. Looking forward to see you more in our webinars during the Space Week. Thank you. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Take care.
Take care.